Great. Well, I'm very pleased to be here and to introduce our final distinguished panel of the day. We're going to be discussing staying within the courts, but moving towards looking at judicial decision making as well as other theories about how blinding might operate in the courts and institutional context. So our first speaker is David Yokum. David's a PhD candidate in psychology at the University of Arizona with dual specializations in neural systems and psychology, policy, and law. He holds a master's degree in bioethics and medical humanities, and his current research explores the cognitive foundations of judgment and decision making.
Thank you for the introduction, and thank everyone here for your continued attention as we reach this final leg on really what has been a fantastic day. So stick with me. My topic is going to be judicial disqualification, and sort of my plan of attack for this is I'm going to speak a little bit about what the legal standard is that judges deploy in deciding whether to disqualify and why that presents some really unique psychological obstacles to doing that accurately. And then I'll turn to what a blinded disqualification review, as I'm referred to it, might be able to offer in terms of a solution. And this is an area that makes a variety of empirical claims, and for the most part, I'm going to draw on some generalizations from research that's already existing. But at a couple of points, there are some novel things about this particular sort of inquiry, and for those, I have some pilot data that I collected actually just over the last few days, figuring that if I'm going to be making empirical claims like that, then as an empiricist, maybe I should try to throw up some data, and we'll see that was a mistake in some ways, because it didn't work as I wanted. But that's good. It's a good mistake. That's why you shouldn't take these sort of things for granted. So disqualification is an area that I became interested in as more and more problems were, or I don't know if problem's the right word, sort of protests were surfacing that judges weren't recusing themselves enough. And this comes up at the highest levels whenever there was sort of anger and frustration at, for example, Supreme Court justices like Scalia not recusing themselves whenever he had gone duck hunting with Cheney and this sort of thing, but really all the way down into the trenches of trial courts also, where oftentimes litigants will be sort of baffled to find themselves saying, you know, this judge is biased against me, and then that judge, him or herself, turns around and makes the decision about whether to disqualify. It kind of seems bizarre that the person who you think is biased would make that decision. And so I was further interested is that the standard, or what judges are supposed to be asking themselves, is that they're supposed to disqualify themselves in any proceeding in which their impartiality might reasonably be questioned. So it's not just if they actually are biased or if they think they're biased. There's actually a dynamic to it that's very explicitly, what will other people think about my bias? And so the fact there's this kind of background of instances in which judges say they're not biased and a lot of people say you are, it seems to be this indication that maybe the standard isn't working the way that we hope it will. And that's what I'm interested in, is why that might be the case psychologically. And there's two steps that a judge goes through in thinking about this. One is this sort of self-inquiry about whether they are in fact biased, and they need to sort of introspect to think about this. But even if they decide that they aren't biased, like I said, they need to sort of consider further whether others might think that they are. And so there's kind of two different ways that they might strike themselves out of this consideration from hearing a case. And from a psychological standpoint, there's a lot of reasons that think that judges will struggle, particularly with that first step of deciding if they themselves are biased for one reason or another. And we saw some examples of this actually today in Sunita's talk, for example, and sort of pointing out that oftentimes we're willing to ascribe bias to others, but we'll deny it in ourselves. And this has sometimes been referred to in the literature as the sort of bias blind spot. We're blind to our own bias. And it's demonstrated rather straightforwardly. In some experience, they'll just give subjects a description of sort of a catalog of all these different biases and ask them to rate, to what extent do you think other people will fall prey to this? To what extent do you think you'll fall prey to it? And the finding that pops up again and again and again is that you can see that with these white bars, they're rating everybody else as, nah, you know, they're going to be biased and bad, but me, no, would never happen to me. And there's a variety of different reasons why this happens, but to give you just sort of one flavor, think about the sources of information that you could rely on for determining whether bias exists. You might introspect for sort of mental traces of bias, sort of think in your own mind. You might rely on sort of overt behavior of bias, for instance, whether somebody really highly deviates from the norm. Or you might rely on sort of theories or stereotypes of bias. And with self-diagnosis, by which I mean thinking about whether you yourself are biased, you have access to all three categories of evidence. On the other hand, if you're diagnosing the bias in someone else, obviously you don't have access to this introspective element. You can't plug into somebody else's mind. And so there's a tendency to have sort of an asymmetric use of information. And the further problem is that this introspective reliance turns out to be faulty in a lot of different ways, sometimes referred to as the introspective illusion. And the general problem is that the mechanisms that generate biases are very often unconscious. So if you try to stop and sort of root around in your mind for mental traces of that evidence, it's going to come up as a false positive because there's nothing there to detect in the first place. It's unconscious. So it can lead people to falsely think that they're unbiased because they're falling prey to this illusion. Now notice that the standard for judges is a little bit of a mixture of the two of these. What they're supposed to do is ask the question, not am I biased? Well, they ask that first, but not only am I biased, not just would others be biased, but will others think I'm biased? And so a thought, an empirical issue here is whether that perspective taking would cause them to use the evidence of all three categories or instead to only rely on those latter two. And so maybe actually reach a judgment that's pretty good. And so here's one where there wasn't data on it, but I went out and did just a simple experiment on MTurk, throwing online a description of a bias, kind of like what was done on the last slide, and then asking, do you think you'll show this bias? Do you think other people will show this bias? Do you think others will think that you do it? And what we find is, first, on the two left-hand columns, the classic self-other difference of saying that other people are going to be biased. And then that third right column is the appearance question. And here you can see a bias blind spot continuing to persist. Or in other words, whenever they're assessing whether others are going to think they're biased, it's as if they're asking the question, am I biased? And they're showing that same gap before. So they don't seem to be any better at answering this question simply because of that perspective taking. And so one solution, a first step of a solution here, is to say that judges shouldn't actually be making the disqualification decision themselves. Let's transfer it to another judge to make the assessment who isn't going to fall prey to things like the introspective illusion. And this is something that, just sort of practically speaking, should be easy enough to do, and I'll just motion towards sort of the evidence of that being that some states are already trying to do precisely this sort of thing. So in some jurisdictions, it's common for a judge who's being challenged with a disqualification motion to first do a sort of a minimal check of whether the motion is perhaps timely and meets sort of facial features, but assuming that that passes that threshold, they don't decide on the further merits. They instead automatically transfer it to another judge. So just sort of practically speaking, that step shouldn't be that difficult to accomplish. But my concern is that there could be lingering troubles even after doing this. And in particular, there could be troubles with the other judge assessing actual bias in the original challenge judge. And this could play out in a couple of ways. One is that if the judge is, for instance, friends or maybe enemies with that judge, then rather than relying on sort of the merits of the challenge, they might just kind of rely on reputation sort of effects to make it the assessment. Or, assuming that they think that there actually is bias and they want to disqualify the judge, they might still be reluctant to do that. It would be sort of a lack of candor because of the social dynamics of what it means to sort of call somebody out in that way. And this is something that I think is particularly difficult for judges because of the culture of judging. And this has sometimes been referred to as this kind of disqualification paradox, where judges, you know, they take an oath to avoid the appearance of partiality. And so if a judge were to say that somebody needs to disqualify themselves, it's really not, I mean, it's something worse than just a disagreement about a legal case law or something like that. It's instead something deeper. It's saying, you know, you as a judge, you're supposed to be somebody who's avoiding these situations to become, this appearance of impartiality, and you failed to do that. So it's almost a more personal kind of attack to where judges are reluctant to make these sort of claims about each other. And another concern is that you might think that laypersons might still find this a little screwy. You know, sure, you're not making the judgment, but you've just passed it to your friend on the court to do. I'm not going to really trust that either. And so I think here is where a blinding sort of mechanism can help on all of these different fronts. And what I mean by blinding here is rather straightforward, something to the effect of taking the disqualification motion And while you're making the transfer to another judge, making some effort to just sort of, it could be as basic as just redacting the names of the parties involved, or maybe trying to do something a little bit more aggressive to remove information that can identify who the challenge judge is. And then assigning that to, perhaps randomly, another judge who's going to render the decision, but their identity is going to be kept anonymous. And that's going to help with the peer pressure dynamic. And there's a lot of different sort of practicalities associated here. You know, there's going to be limits, for instance, on how well you can keep the identity of the challenge judge secret. If the case facts, for example, are really publicly made, then maybe even when you remove the name, it's going to be able to figure it out. And I kind of concede that that's going to be the case around the margin. And there could be issues with court size. You know, for instance, if you're in California, then it's, you know, there's a lot of judges that these that might be challenged or might be doing the reviewing. If you're in Maine, on the other hand, you know, it's you and a couple of other people around there. So it might be easier to try to infer exactly who the people are that might disrupt the effectiveness on the blind of the blind. But on the margin, I'm suggesting that this can go quite a long way towards getting some of these benefits, particularly on the actual bias part. And I think a parallel here with peer review is of academic journals is actually helpful. In that sort of a context, oftentimes you can still infer who the author is because perhaps you know something about their research agenda or writing style. But we still generally think, and studies have generally shown, that peer review, despite those limits, can make progress on avoiding some of these actual biases. Now, what about this other claim, though? What I'm suggesting is that laypersons judging or assessing the disqualification decision that's made might be more accepting of it or consider the judicial system more legitimate if it's made through this blinded mechanism as opposed to having the judge him or herself make it themselves. So this would be kind of like an added bonus benefit of using the blinded process, and one that's, you know, nicely tethered to what the standard is all about, namely kind of keeping up the appearances of impartiality of the judicial system. And so here is the empirical claim. And this is the one that, you know, 2 days ago I decided that as an empiricist coming here, I was like, all right, well, maybe I'll just try to throw up a vignette or something like that to prove that this actually works. And this was the one that I thought it was going to be obvious and that it would just give me a nice data point to talk about. And here's what I did. I did this online. I had a cover story that was actually modeled off of the Caperton case where there was a trial verdict that awarded a really large punitive damages sum against the defendant. And that defendant went on to infuse a large amount of money into a candidate for the Court of Appeals that ended up winning and defeating somebody on the court who was previously believed to be someone who would uphold that punitive damages award. And so the call started to come out as in the real case, and then I suggested here in the article as well, that this judge who was brought on by this infusion of cash of the defendant, they really need to remove themselves from the case because they're going to be so heavily indebted to them for the money that they contributed to their campaign. And so that part was kept common for everyone. And then I experimentally randomized subjects to read one of three different versions about how this disqualification decision was going to be handled. The first was sort of the status quo of just saying that Mississippi law requires such a motion to be decided by the judge him or herself. And the judge goes on to deny the motion and gives an explanation along the lines of, you know, being absolutely confident in my ability to uphold my oath of office, continue on to sort of note that in Mississippi, judges, just as an actual matter, they rely heavily on campaign funds, so it's sort of inevitable this is going to happen. And, you know, even though I happen to know the defendant, it's a very minimal relationship, you know, so giving some sort of a reason for why he thinks he shouldn't be disqualified. And the other condition, what I did is I just changed this to where the case was transferred to another judge, but not a blinded judge. In this case, it was Judge J. Hickory, a nice Mississippi name, as Chris pointed out to me before. And he denies the motion as well and gives the identical reasons. So after considering the motion, I'm confident in Judge Tetlock's yada, 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 the same explanation given as in the first case. And then in the third version, it was a double-blind review sort of mechanism that I attempted to describe here. And this, you can see it was tweaked to just say, Mississippi law requires such a motion to be considered by a blinded judge. I needed to make some decisions about how to describe this, but the way I said it was, you know, a blinded judge decides the request without knowing which particular judge is being challenged and without his or her own identity disclosed to the judge being challenged. He or she denied, and then the exact same reasons are given. So it's really just chasing the source of who made this disqualification decision. and proceeded to ask a variety of questions getting at perceptions of whether the judge was going to, Judge Tetlock, the original challenge judge, was going to be affected by the fact that he was going to hear the case. So for instance, do you agree or disagree that Judge Tetlock will serve as a fair and impartial judge? Are you confident in a judicial system where judges like Judge Tetlock are there? Do you think that Judge Tetlock is going to reverse the jury award? Do you think the decision was correct, whether to not disqualify him? And then a final question at the bottom about to what extent do you think Judge Tetlock is going to be affected by that funding? So all kind of trying to get at the same general idea of do you think that the fact that they haven't been disqualified is indicative of a true lack of bias? And my prediction was that those who saw him make the decision himself would answer this in a sort of pattern that's like, oh yeah, he's going to be biased. He's going to rule to overturn the verdict. But those who saw another judge do it would be a little bit more trusting, and those who saw the blinded mechanism would be the most confident that it was going to be an impartial verdict. So that's what I thought. And then here are the results. And I've coded these in the direction so that higher numbers are better in the sense that it's, for instance, saying that, to take this left-hand column, this was a question about whether you think the judge is going to uphold the jury verdict, or in other words, whether you think he's going to overturn and basically decide adversely to the person who contributed all of that money to them. And you can see on something like this, the gray lines are that double-blinded review mechanism that I was talking about, and it gets a rating significantly lower than either the self or the other scenario. In other words, they think that he's more likely to sort of overturn the jury verdict if they've gone through the double blind. As you move over, you can see that the distinction, it's difficult to tell whether it's the blind doing the work here or something about the other judge doing it, but as you move over, you can see that again and again and again and again, they trust the decision when it's made by the judge himself more than whenever it was switched over to the other person, or in particular whenever it was a double-blinded review mechanism. So why might that be? I have 45 seconds left, which is good because I don't have a tremendous amount to say about this quite yet, and I'll blame it on the lack of time. But what's interesting about this is that it raises a larger question that I think is interesting for this group to think about, which is, you know, what are the parameters in which blinding is limited and can potentially backfire? And something like here, you know, maybe in a legal culture that really values transparency and an open record and really knowing everything about it, something like a blind seems kind of shady. You know, why are judges who are supposed to be so much in the open suddenly doing something behind closed doors? Maybe it's not that. Maybe it has something to do with the fact that I didn't explain it very well. You know, maybe if you flesh out the explanation in more detail and give people more of a chance to learn about it, we can start to make some progress. And I think that's a live possibility. It's not totally satisfying as sort of a policy answer to me, because oftentimes the exposure that people are going to get to court cases are going to be something like a news article with a 30-second blurb like this. So I think this might be the sort of thing people are going to see anyway. But maybe it's kind of a news clip problem. And there's more work to be done on this, and I actually have more data rolling in literally at the moment that wasn't ready in time, but maybe it will be for the next symposium. So thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Professor Anup Malani, who joins us from, Professor Malani is the Lee and Brenda Freeman Professor at the University of Chicago Law School and Professor at the Pritzker School of Medicine. He's also a university scholar at Resources for the Future in Washington, a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Studies in Boston, a senior fellow at the Schaeffler Center at the University of Southern California, and an editor at the Journal of Law and Economics. Today he's going to be presenting on why non-publication of legal decisions can prevent hurting on bad rules. Please welcome Professor Malani.
Okay. When Chris invited me to present at this conference, when we talked about the sorts of papers that I could write, he and I told him about this paper. He said, "Well, that's a form of blinding, I suppose." So I'm not entirely convinced by that, but we'll go with it for the purposes of this talk. So what I'm going to be talking about is why it is that it might be a good idea to allow judges not to publish decisions that they make. Make them make the decision, but allow them not to publish it. And that's important because that means that future judges won't know about that decision. Okay? So let me start out by fleshing out the framing a little bit. So in the common law tradition, judges are thought to learn from prior decisions. Stand on the shoulders of giants in the law. So I see what prior judges did, and that informs my decisions in the case that's before me if I were a judge. Now, at the same time, though, even though we have this desire to generate precedents, we give judges the ability to decide cases without publishing their decisions. In fact, this is more of the norm at the district court level than it is the appellate level, but it's still part of the norm at the appellate level. You can decide not to publish. Some of you in the audience might say, wait a second, can't you still cite non-published opinions? Yes, although that's a recent rule. For much of the history of the common law tradition, you've been able not to publish your decision, okay? And a lot of legal scholars, I would say the most legal scholars criticize this practice. They say, oh, well, that just demonstrates that judges are lazy. They're shirking because producing an opinion is a public good. It informs the next set of judges. And also, you know, when they don't publish, we lose out on accountability. Publication makes you accountable. You have to give a reason why you voted. You know, you avoid the judge from the last case, Metlock, right? And I want to suggest that intuition may not be right. I want to suggest that non-publication could be a very rational response in a context where the way judicial decision-making is done, there's a significant risk of hurting, which is that you follow the guy before you just because the guy before you did what he did or she did, and not because it's the right decision. It is the case that different judges have different quality of cases before them. Sometimes you have a good set of litigants, sometimes you have a bad set of litigants, sometimes you have good facts, sometimes you have bad facts. And what I'm basically going to say, or basically going to argue theoretically and then hopefully empirically, is that what non-publication allows you to do, assuming you're a forward-looking judge that cares about the law generally and not just being lazy, is that it allows you to censor from the sight of future judges bad cases. Cases where the litigants were bad, the lawyers were bad, the facts were bad, whatever it happens to be, okay? And I'm gonna give you suggestive data, or data that suggests that in fact this explanation may be correct. Okay, so it's not just theory. So very quickly, in a heavily dense slide, let me just tell you that there's two strands of literature that we're contributing to beyond the fact that we're now talking about it as an issue of blinding. There's a large literature about whether or not the evolution of law through the common law system, where judges listen to what prior judges say and then build upon that, leads to efficient, and by efficient I mean better because I'm an economist, results. This was started by Judge Posner, who suggested that, in fact, the common law leads to efficiency, and it's been debated on and off, and what I'm saying now kind of is in that line. At the same time, there's a significant economics literature about the problem of hurting, and basically the idea here is that if you've got a bunch of people that get private information about a choice, let's say what restaurant to go to, and they make decisions about whether or not to go to this restaurant in sequence, and they can observe what people before them do, but they can't observe the private signal that the person before them got, then you're going to get a situation where people are going to herd, and not necessarily herd on the right thing. Meaning, I'm going to go to a restaurant, even though I think it's a bad restaurant, because I see enough people before me went to that restaurant. And that's going to be a very rational response. But it's a very rational response from a Bayesian perspective in particular, but it's socially suboptimal because it causes me to underweight my private information that I have about the quality of that restaurant. It's a well-known result, actually. Abhijit Banerjee, who lives, I think, in Cambridge, is one of the main people that came up with this idea, and it spawned a huge literature. It has had a huge influence in finance. It's even had an influence in law, where, as it turns out, we comply with the assumptions behind the herding model, which is judges make decisions in sequence. They don't tell you all the details about the facts of the case. Instead, they announce a decision, which synthesizes those facts. And so they don't reveal the private signal. They just give you a course action. Plaintiff wins, defendant wins. There's privity in a case, there's not privity in a case, something like that. Okay, and people have pointed this out. So Rangnam and Doherty have pointed out that judges may be subject to herding. At the same time, there is a little bit of internal debate in the law about whether or not there actually is herding in the common law. A guy named Eric Talley says, well, no, judges don't just announce plaintiff wins, plaintiff loses. They give, they write cases, and the cases can sometimes tell you, is this a good quality signal or a low quality signal? Is this a signal that the plaintiff was right or wrong? Things like that, or whether they're just following precedent. And so there is an active debate about whether this occurs. And that's the debate that we are trying to contribute to, that the merger of this economics literature and that lot literature. Let me give you some real world examples for those of you that are not lawyers, to tell you about the sorts of questions that lawyers are dealing with, that judges are dealing with, and the context in which this sort of herding and non-publication play a role. So let's just take the first one, which is a really simple one, because I know I have very limited time. So imagine you have a series of state courts, different states in the United States, they're different jurisdictions, and they have to decide whether or not to require privity in products liability suits. So if you buy a car from Chevrolet and the tire is produced by Firestone, or the tire blows, and you want to know and you want to be able to sue because the tire blew, are you as the consumer able to sue Firestone? Or is it that only Chevrolet can sue Firestone because Firestone supplied to Chevrolet and Chevrolet supplied to you, and you did not have a direct contract with Firestone? You lacked privity. Okay? It's a very old issue that's been long decided. The answer is you can, just in case this happens to you. But the issue is that judges in different states had to decide. Similar sorts of things might happen, for example, with a statute like FERPA, which is about privacy of your educational records, and whether or not an individual should be able to sue for violations of FERPA by a university like Harvard. Which Harvard would never do, of course. But that would be the sorts of, that's the context we're talking about. Now, the issue that I want to ask about is should judges always have to publish their opinions when they're deciding these cases? So the first person that decides on a privity case, should they have to publish? Should the second guy have to publish? Third guy have to publish? Or should you say, hey, the second guy can decide not to publish, okay? Most lawyers, I think, would say publish, and I'm going to suggest not. So let me... I'm an economist. I like models. I have trouble understanding data unless I have a model in my head, so that I know what the data, what I'm testing. So that's what I'm going to give you a model that's going to seem a little bit complicated, but I don't actually think it's very complicated. It's going to start out by assuming that there's a sequence of judges, 1, 2, and 3. They're going to make decisions in sequence over the same legal question. Okay? When judge one makes a decision, first, judge one gets a signal about whether or not the right answer is A or B, okay, and then decides the decision, A or B, okay? And the judge can also decide whether or not to publish that decision or not, okay? If the judge decides to publish that decision, then when judge two comes along, judge two not only gets her private signal about whether or not the facts before her suggest the answer is A or B, but can also see that the prior judge said that the answer is A. And remember, it's the same legal question, okay? Same thing happens, and Judge B can decide whether or not to publish, and then Judge 2 can decide whether or not to publish, and then it goes to Judge 3. You get the idea? That's basically the model that we're talking about, okay? And then I think the outcome of this model is a sequence of cases with decisions that look something like AA, BB, AC. I can introduce a third option. You can decide C as well as A or B, okay? And so that's the outcome of this sort of model, and I want to figure out, are you getting the right answer? And I'm going to, without loss of generality, just pick A, B, or C as being the right answer, okay? Because I'm just trying to figure out whether you converge to A and how often you do that, okay? Here's an important thing to remember in this model and why this model differs from the standard herding model. Am I already out of time?
No.
Oh, good. That would have been really early. First of all, I'm going to assume that different cases are of different quality. Sometimes you get good litigants, sometimes you get bad litigants. That's important to this. I'm also going to care that judges care about the future. They don't just care about getting the answer right in their case. They actually care about making sure that other judges in the future get the right answer, right? I'm thinking the best judges, okay? The kind of judges we really, really want, okay? And I'm going to say judges can be allowed to hide their decisions by publishing. And when they decide not to publish, they actually really substantively hide the cases, okay? So this is one thing I want to stress that's really important. For those of you in the audience that have actually care about judicial decision making, you'll notice that a lot of the literature, the prior literature, focuses on trying to explain what judges do by asking things like, are they Democrat or Republican? Basically, they appeal to judicial preferences. I don't like that approach methodologically, and I can tell you in the Q&A why that's a bad idea to go down that road. I'm going to take what I think is a methodologically better way to get a more parsimonious answer. I'm going to assume judges have common preferences. Okay, so what they really just care about is the case. And I'm also going to not try to tell you a labor market story for why judges do what they do. In my model, I assume that decision making takes no effort. It's costless for judges to do, okay? And then I'm going to try to explain people's behavior. Okay, I don't want to go into the math, but I do want to tell you the theoretical results and just tell you the intuition behind them. Okay, if in this model, I assume that judges not only saw the quality of their own signals, but they saw the quality of prior judges' signals, in fact, all judges' signals, okay, what would they do? Well, they would do the same thing as what a prior judge does if they got the same signal, A or B, but they would do they would not necessarily follow the prior judge's signal if the quality of their own signal was better. Again, they, under the assumption they know the quality of the prior judge's signal and their own signal, they'll follow the higher quality signal, okay? Now, take one more step. Let's suppose that a judge doesn't know the quality of the prior judge's signal. They don't know the quality of the litigants in the prior case. They only know the decision. You know what they're going to do? They're going to, and let's suppose that the prior decision is different than the private signal they're getting in their own case. What are they going to do? They're going to follow their own case rather than the prior case if they think the quality of the litigants before them is better than the expected quality of the signal that the last judge got. Because they don't know the actual signal, so they're going to follow expected quality of signals. This is just another stepping stone in the model. Okay. Now, one implication of this is that for any fixed number of cases that are addressing a legal question, just take, you know, any three cases in a row, you're going to find that there is a right skew in the distribution of disagreements, okay? Right? And the reason why there's a right skew in the distribution of disagreements is because I'm always looking to see what the expected, I'm a judge, wherever I am in the sequence, I'm going to look to see what the quality of my signal is relative to the amalgam of quality of prior signals, even though I don't observe those prior signals. But the larger the number of people that are before me that have decided cases, the larger is the expected quality of the amalgam of cases. So I'm less likely to rely on more my case rather than prior cases. This is the quintessential herding result. The quintessential herding result implies that you're basically going to have a right skew in disagreements. The probability that a judge is going to disagree with people before them declines over time as the set of cases becomes larger and larger. Okay? But again, that just comes from standard herding. That's not my innovation. I'm just pointing this out. Now let's talk about some of the things that when you introduce variable quality and non-publication, you get. Okay? Now let's suppose that you have variable quality of signals across judges. One interesting thing that you're going to find is that the minimum quality that a judge's signal has to be before she publishes her opinion, or actually just follows that private signal rather than what comes before her, that minimum quality level rises over time. You hold yourself to a higher standard as more and more people decide before you. Okay? Again, that's intuitive. I like that you shrugged. That means you agree with me. It's pretty obvious, right? Okay?
I'm also an economist.
All right. So this is really easy, right? So then let me point out one other thing, which is if you are the first, let's suppose that you have a bunch of judges. They decide A, 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 and then you see a B. Okay? And you're the judge that follows the B. You know something. Given that the minimum quality standards for disagreeing are rising over time, you know that the guy that just said B has to be way more confident in their signal than the guys before them, okay, in expectation. So after you see a first B, you are much more likely to say B than you are to say A, even if there are way more number of A's before you, okay? So once there's a disagreement, that disagreement is sticky. That's the main insight from the theory. And that's testable, okay? Now, one interesting thing that comes from this also is if this is true, then it's also the case that you want to, you can improve the quality of cases where quality is measured by the probability that you're getting the right answer if you allow people before judges to not publish cases. Because if you give them the option not to publish cases, you know what they'll rationally do? They'll rationally not publish cases where the quality of the case is particularly low, okay? And that's why in this model, it's gonna be the case that you wanna give people the opportunity not to publish cases, okay? So if two predictions are true, it's gonna normatively follow that you wanna give judges the opportunity not to publish. So here are the two predictions. One is that there's herding, which is a right skew in the appearance of what I call a B decision, the first disagreement in any sequence. And the second one is that once you have a disagreement, it's sticky. It's disproportionately sticky, okay? Meaning if you just, if you got A, B, you would think the probability the next guy's gonna go to B is 1/3. I'm gonna say it's the probability is actually higher than 1/3, okay? So I took data on 400 circuit splits reported nicely for me by US Law Week. I coded it into a sequence, A, B, and C. Each sequence is on a particular case, on particular, particular legal question, okay? And then I check to see if these two predictions are true. If the two predictions are true, then I can also make the normative claim that it's a good idea for judges to not be able to publish, okay? So here's what we find. We find that there's an insignificant, but there is some evidence, so it's not statistically significant, evidence of a right skew in the location of B decisions, meaning the first split, okay? So for example, if you say, what is the probability of observing AAB versus ABA? And I would say that you have a 0.03 probability higher of observing AAB than an ABA. And the P is low just because I'm confining my sample to sequences that are 3. If I'm able to amalgamate a larger number, the p-values become more significant, but they're still not going to, I haven't found among 400 splits that it's below 0.1, okay? So there's hurting, but you can't be super confident in. That said, I find really strongly significant evidence that there's stickiness. So for example, if you take the probability that you're going to see, after you see AAB, you ask yourself, is the next case going to be a B or is it going to be an A, okay? It should be, statistically, more often an A than a B, right, on a 1/3 basis. In fact, what you find, the probability that it's a B is 0.5, and the p-value is very, very significant. Meaning there's stickiness, which reflects this idea that there's variability in the quality of cases, and that people appreciate that there's rising standard in the quality of cases, okay? From that, it follows that if judges, right, because they're raising their standard of proof, if judges have the ability not to decide cases, they're also going to be making better decisions. Okay? That last one is a normative claim. It's not testable. Okay? All right. Now, as it turns out, there are lots of nice predictions that come from this model. I've only focused on one of them, which is this idea that you want to not publish. And that can be a good thing. Or that is to say, the predicates for coming to a conclusion that you don't want to publish, that there's evidence for that. But there are other ways, other predictions we can make that are a little bit more direct. So you can, for example, predict that the judges are less likely to publish decisions as an issue matures. So it's not just a claim about whether or not you disagree, but about whether or not you publish. You can also talk about when judges are citing precedents, they're more likely to cite the most recent precedent rather than old precedents when they're disagreeing precedents. And those are things that we're in the process of testing now. But I think the important normative implication, it's important to be clear about what these normative implications are, and on this I'll end. So I will argue, or I think I've convinced myself, and I hope I've convinced you, that the ability not to publish a case, which runs contrary to the grain of conventional wisdom in legal circles, the ability not to publish a decision increases the accuracy of rules that you see, conditional on the number of cases that are published. Okay, that's what I've done. The one caveat I want to issue, though, is that that doesn't necessarily mean you get to the truth more quickly. Because when you allow non-publication, you also mean that if there's a regular flow of cases, there's a slower flow of published cases. Okay? And it's published cases that get you to the right answer. And so it's not obvious that you get to the correct answer more quickly. It just means that you're more likely, given a certain amount of published opinions, to get to the right answer. And so that's the limited way in which I will say non-publication, a form of hiding information, which is the theme of this conference, can be a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Our third and final speaker of the day is Jeff Skopek, who is currently a fellow at the Harvard's P.G. Flom Center. He received his J.D. from Harvard Law School and also holds a Ph.D. and M.Phil in History and Philosophy of Science from the University of Cambridge. His current research explores the distinction between anonymity and privacy in various areas of the law. Today, he'll be speaking on information rules for institutional design.
Thanks. So Today I'm going to be talking about part of a broader research project that explores the role of anonymity in our law. And I'm going to suggest that anonymity can be found operating across our law in ways that have gone unrecognized in domains ranging from contract and copyright to criminal law and constitutional law. By way of introduction, I'll give you two examples. The first is from June 1997, when many citizens of Alston, Massachusetts learned to their anger that they had recently sold land to Harvard University. Harvard had spent over 8 years and $88 million acquiring over 50 acres of land anonymously using buying agents, which under the law of undisclosed agency can protect the anonymity of their principal, even by falsely representing that they're not acting on behalf of any principal in most cases. That's the rule. My second example comes from Election Day 2012, when 22% of voters disclosed how they voted on social media websites such as Facebook or Twitter. Many did so by posting photos of their completed ballots, only to learn to their surprise that they had violated state election law in doing so. They did not realize that anonymity in voting was not actually a right, but actually a requirement. So one of the questions that my research explores is, if and how these two very different types of uses of anonymity are related. And so today I'll present three components of my research. I'll start with a survey and taxonomic analysis of the various rules in our law that either limit or actually provide personal identifying information about people. I'll then turn to the question of whether there's any coherence to these rules and what functions they perform. And then I'll discuss some implications of my analysis for institutional design. So I'll start with a sort of broad survey and taxonomy. So across nearly every area of law, we can find rules that control the availability of personal identifying information. So at times, I'll sort of talk about two general categories of rules. So we have entitlement rules, under which anonymity is a right, and conditioning rules, under which anonymity is a condition of exercising right. Those are sort of titles that came up with to try to capture these general categories of rules. And furthermore, within each of these two categories, we also have the sort of the opposite version of the rule, so where attribution is a right or attribution is a condition of exercising a right. And I think that those are useful to put on the table as a way of thinking about when we might not want anonymity. So to provide you a rough sense of the sort of scope and breadth of these rules across our law, I'll just briefly go through a few examples of each stated simply without many of the sort of complexities that I talk about in the paper. So in the category of entitlement rules, for example, we have anonymity as a right of those who contract through agents, as I just mentioned. It's a right of sperm donors protected by state statute, common law, and constitutional law. It's a right of participants in witness protection programs and various bounty schemes, such as that created by the False Claims Act. It's an aspect of the First Amendment right of free speech and association. It's a right that's granted to witnesses, jurors, and parties in some particularly sensitive litigation cases. Attribution, on the other hand, is a right under certain artwork, under the Visual Artist Rights Act. It's a right of authors and copyrighted works under the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. And it's a right of parents and their children, protected by childbirth recording statutes. Moving to conditioning rules, we have anonymity as a condition of exercising one's right to deposit one's vote in a general election ballot box, of buying and selling futures in certain heavily regulated industries. So for example, PG&E, when it wants to buy and sell certain sorts of futures, it actually has to do so anonymously under state regulatory authority. It's out in California. Anonymity is also a condition of taking certain examinations, for example, law school or auditioning for orchestras. And it's a condition of donating organs in some jurisdictions that don't allow directed donation, although those are increasingly uncommon in the United States. It's very common in France and other parts of Europe. Finally, in the category of conditioning rules under the attribution box, we have attribution as a condition of voting as an elected official. It's a condition of donating money to a politician or engaging in electioneering communications, signing a legislative petition, participating in the judicial system, generally speaking, except in those cases that I mentioned earlier, and providing a tip to the police that constitutes probable cause. So across nearly every area of law, we can find rules that regulate the availability of personal identifying information. And one of the questions my research explores is whether these, just, you know, that we can tell any sort of coherent story about our law's uses of these rules. So the central claim that I'm going to make today is that these rules can be generally understood as facilitating or controlling the public circulation of a wide variety of socially desirable goods, which I'll sort of define broadly to include things ranging from classic public goods, such as information, to other sorts of things that we think perform important public functions, ranging from, you know, funding of scientific research to uncorrupted votes. And I'm going to identify and explore two different phases of decision making that are targeted by these rules. Sometimes the rules target decisions that impact the production of these goods, ex ante, and sometimes the rules target decisions involving the evaluation of these goods, ex post. And in this analysis, I might sometimes push the boundaries of what we mean when we talk about information leading to better decisions. So I'll start by looking at decisions that impact the production of goods. And here my claim is that anonymity and attribution rules can be generally understood as reallocating the costs and benefits of creating a good in order to align private incentives with public goals and values. And so there's two, perhaps, primary ways in which this happens. The first is through the entitlement rules, which allow the entitlement holder to decide whether or not the public is going to have access to information about his or her identity. And these rules, I think, can perform a crucial role in making sure that the entitlement holder has the incentives to produce certain goods that we might want produced. So take, for example, the right to contract. Sorry, that should actually be under the anonymity. So the right to contract anonymously, that should be on the other side. Sorry about that. If a copper company did not have the right to contract anonymously, it would actually have reduced incentives to invest in discovering information about copper owned on land by others, as its offer to purchase the land would alert the owner, oh, my land might have copper on it. So ex ante, you know, you would expect that this situation would cause to a decline in investments in this potentially socially valuable information. The owner of the land would free ride on the ability to infer that their land has copper and raise the price and decrease incentives. So the anonymity rule here, I think, removes this socially inefficient dependency, making sure that the parties have the proper incentives, or potentially proper incentives. So the second main way of targeting creation or the production of these goods is with conditioning rules, which, unlike entitlement rules, actually control the incentives that the parties face. So they do so by either allowing or preventing the public to reward or sanction parties based on how they act. For example, requiring anonymity in elections is meant to ensure that the voter is only accountable to himself, that others will not be able to reward or punish him or her based on how he or she votes. The requirement that legislative votes be attributed, on the other hand, does the opposite. It ensures that our elected officials are accountable to us, that they have the right sort of dependence. So now I'll turn to the second main target of these rules, which is, I think, decisions concerning the evaluation of goods that have been created. So this is perhaps the more intuitive way in which the rules can lead to better decisions. And here, the improvement, I think, can take one of two forms. One way of improving decision making is by increasing the accuracy or the efficiency of the evaluation. For example, the requirement that election ads be attributed can help viewers more easily evaluate the claims being made. And for campaign contributions, attribution can help us diagnose corruption or, you know, perhaps even discern the interests that the candidate is more likely to represent. Likewise, on the anonymity side, academic journals conduct blind review of submissions, law schools use anonymous grading, symphony orchestras audition candidates behind a screen, all to increase efficiency and accuracy in evaluation. But I don't think it's only efficiency and accuracy that are targeted by these rules. And they can also be used to control the factors that enter into evaluation based on a normative conception of the good at issue. So for instance, an employer might require that an employee submit an anonymized version of their CV for use in the early stages of the hiring process on the theory that certain types of identifying information, such as race, or gender are inappropriate to use in evaluating the candidate, whether or not they might actually improve the accuracy or efficiency of the evaluation. And you know, similar sorts of arguments that are made against statistical justifications for racial profiling. So even if it's actually efficient in some cases for the police to use this information, we actually think that it's improper for other reasons. And finally, while thus are focused on cases in which we require anonymity or attribution, there's also cases in which we leave the decision in the hands of the party whose identity is at issue. So copyright law provides both rights of anonymity and attribution to authors of creative works, where a name or pseudonym can actually help people more easily identify the types of works in which they want to invest their time, attention, and money. So in short, my general theoretical claim here is that anonymity and attribution rules can perform common set of functions across the production and evaluation of goods. I'm sort of using this idea of the life cycle of the good as a framing way of thinking about the different targets where these rules can intervene. So they can either intervene in the acts of getting people to make these things, to do certain sorts of activities, or they can intervene after we have that information, that artwork, that campaign donation, to help us make some sort of evaluative decision about what's occurred. And so it's worth emphasizing here that I'm not actually arguing that any of these rules are normatively justified for the reasons I've actually identified. I'm just trying to provide an explanation of how these rules function. And then we could decide whether or not we actually think that those functions normatively justify them. That's outside the scope of this project. So in the final part of my talk, I want to turn to the question of how this taxonomy and sort of theoretical construct that I've presented can help us make better decisions about the design of institutions. And so I'm going to focus on one general application of my analysis, which is that it helps explain the counterintuitive fact that we've been talking about today, which is that you can solve a conflict of interest by requiring anonymity or by requiring attribution. And to most people, this would seem counterintuitive, because how can you solve the same problem with opposite rules? And so the reason, I think, is that they target what I've characterized as different phases in the production life cycle. So for example, there are current rules requiring that scientists, expert witnesses, and politicians disclose their sources of funding all attempt to address the problem of conflicts of interest by targeting the evaluation of the resulting good. They allow the public to alter their evaluations of a scientific conclusion, of an expert opinion, or of a policy decision based on their evaluation of the bias created by the conflict. So these rules are at their core ex post strategies for solving the problem. The use of an anonymity requirement, by contrast, would solve the problem by targeting the production of the good. So by funneling money through an intermediary, the strategy would prevent the conflict from emerging, would get at it, rather than trying to manage it after it's emerged, which is the strategy of targeting evaluation. So a few observations, I think, follow from this framing. The first is the idea that less information leads to better decisions actually has to be qualified in this case. So while blinding might lead to a better decision by the politician or by the scientist, it does not necessarily lead to a better decision by the public ex post. And this can have some costs. For example, as Jonathan Marks highlighted this morning, industry funding can bias science in systemic ways, and these can be obscured by blinding, even if it solves other biasing problems. And actually, in the Q&A, I thought it was interesting, the question came up whether or not, you know, blinding's ever bad. And I was thinking, well, actually, here is a case where, you know, maybe not knowing where the money came from would actually cause the public to fail to inquire into those potential biasing effects. So by focusing on production over here, we're failing to account for the costs that happen over there on the evaluation side. Further, what this suggests is that the use of blinding here is actually different, I think, from in some of the other cases where we've been talking about it. So, you know, when we're talking about blinding and scientific experiments, my orchestra auditions, law school exams, in all these cases, it actually seems to me that there is no sort of ex post cost, no cost down the road. That these things are all targeting just this, in those cases, actually, you have, targeting only, there aren't two aspects of the problem, there's only one, so blinding is sort of a pure benefit, or potentially a pure benefit, whereas in these cases, there's actually a more complicated story to be told. And so the second, more general lesson, I think, for my analysis is that we should always ask the question whether or not we should move between the box that we're currently in. So whenever we're over here, we should ask whether we should be here and vice versa. So far today, we've been talking about cases where we might move from an attribution strategy over to an anonymity strategy. But we could also look for possibilities of moving in the opposite direction. So for example, in elections, we use blinding as a strategy for avoiding corruption. So we think that if votes are anonymous, people aren't going to be corrupted. And this strategy focuses on the relationship between the voter and the potentially corrupting party. It makes it very hard for somebody to corrupt your vote if they can't ever ask for evidence of how you voted. But we can instead focus on the relationship between the voter and the public. And if we focus on that relationship, it might actually seem that attribution, requiring that votes be attributed, would be a better solution, or rather, an equally viable solution to the problem of corruption. And actually, John Stuart Mill actually argued that votes should be attributed precisely for this reason. He thought you'd get less corruption. So what this suggests briefly is that whenever we're choosing a rule, we shouldn't be focusing on just on the nature of the good at issue. I think frequently we think, oh, votes should be anonymous. These sorts of things should be disclosed. We actually need to be engaging in a very different analysis. We need to be asking what problem are we trying to solve and what margin of the problem is going to be more easily amenable to a solution. And here we actually have to get to the hard questions that have sort of come up today. So, factors to consider are whether or not we can actually impose anonymity or attribution effectively. Often it's going to be the worst case solution will be one in which you have partial anonymity or partial attribution. So, and on this count, I think that anonymity strategies are at a significant disadvantage because it's fairly easy to pierce anonymity to end up with only partial anonymity, either unintentionally as a result of other information flows or actually intentionally because parties are trying to resist it. So on that count, I think anonymity is going to be at a disadvantage. However, I think that the other factor is, of course, what's a more efficacious strategy? And here, for the reasons we've been discussing today, attribution is going to be far less effective than we often think it is. And this is because attribution strategies rely on people to perform a lot of sophisticated forms of analysis that they actually might not be able to perform, like accurately discounting expert witness opinion, or figuring out whether corruption has caused a policy change. And furthermore, they actually require people to be able to act on those things. So in the voting context, it might be the case that you think that a given politician is a bit corrupt, but you actually might not have another politician on the ballot. So we have to look at those sort of more contextual issues in deciding which rule we should choose. So in short, I think that anonymity and attribution strategies are often going to have inversely related benefits. And so it's just going to depend on, in the context, which ends up being stronger. And so briefly, though, before I run out of time, I wanted to talk about a few other ways in which I think this framework provides us with some benefits. So I think that generally what this does is it shows that we have these four rules we can play around with, and we have sort of two targets, two phases in the life cycle of a good that we can seek to intervene on. And when we realize this, we realize that there's actually a lot more options to play with when we're designing institutions. So I'll briefly just discuss two, or rather I'll just mention them. So one is, this is one we currently have in our law. So you're allowed to give an anonymous tip to the police. And the idea is that we want people to give tips to the police. So an anonymous tip is better than no tip at all. However, we actually layer this with a rule over here. So attribution is required for your tip to constitute probable cause. In and of itself, an anonymous tip can constitute probable cause. No court has ever held that it can. It's actually not a per se legal rule to that effect. But surveys have found that judges categorically say an anonymous tip alone is not enough. So anyway, we use two rules to solve one problem. We layer them. And finally, as I think I'm about out of time, this is a sort of a reading of an Ayers and Ackerman strategy. So I'll try to bring us back to where Larry Lessig started us this morning, which is as Ayers and Ackerman have proposed that we potentially could use blinding as a solution to institutional corruption caused by campaign donations. And their sort of first preference strategy would be actually require that the donations be anonymous. But then they later on realized that maybe that's not going to work for political reasons. So they said, OK, here is another option. So we keep our current status quo rule. Attribution campaign campaign donations have to be attributed. And we're targeting the evaluation like we currently do, try to flesh out corruption by looking at those donations. However, they said, let's actually give people the option of having an anonymous refund. So the idea is that the money would all go into a pot, it would be attributed, but then people could anonymously take their money out of the pot and the politician wouldn't know who did so. So by actually layering rules, targeting different phases in the life cycle, we actually get to a potentially more nuanced solution. So I think that generally in our law, we could be slightly more sophisticated in institutional design once we realize the set of tools and design levers that we have at our disposal. Thanks.
Thanks very much. I'd like to open up to questions from the audience. Jonathan, you start us off. Jonathan, oh, yeah, the microphone's going.
Thank you so much. That was.
Is it off?
Can you hear me? Yes. Thank you so much. That was a great panel. I'm just going to quickly, a little tidbit for each of you. So just following up on Jeffrey Skopek's point, I think you're right that if blinding meant that you didn't know how much industry money was coming into certain research institutions, that would be problematic. But actually, we're in the situation, so in relation to food and nutrition right now, we have no idea how much industry money is going in. So if the blinding plus the intermediary allowed for the collection of that data and the publication of that data by the intermediary, then you wouldn't have an exacerbation of the problem. And then just a couple of things for David and Anup. Quickly for David, when I was counsel in full-time practice in London, I was in the Pinochet case, and what is called the Supreme Court now had to hear the case twice because Lord Hoffman had an affiliation with Amnesty International, and Amnesty was an intervener in the proceedings. And that led to a whole series of challenges of judicial decisions on the basis of conflict of interest, allegations that judges should have recused themselves. And what happened was all those failed, where they were based on pecuniary interests because they were so far removed. The one that succeeded was a judge who had written something in very trenchant terms, and the Court of Appeals said, well, you know, how could he decide the case, whether it was this point of law arose with an open mind because he'd written about it in such trenchant terms. So I'd love to hear your thought on that. And then very quickly for Anup, you talked about blinding in one sense of not publishing. There's another kind of blindness, which is not looking. And you might arguably say that there's a great deal of that kind of blindness in the system right now because we don't look in the US at international decisions in the same way that happens in other legal systems. So I wanted your thought about that. And one final thought. When I first came to the US and to study law as a summer intern in 1989, I remember finding this case, and it said, it is axiomatic that C, and then there was a reference. And I went back to that case, and it said it was axiomatic too, with no explanation. And I had to go back 23 cases until I found a case that explained why, and it was a very poor explanation. I'll stop there.
So I had a question for Anup on the stickiness assertion. I was wondering if some of the data results might be due to sort of generational issues. I mean, so if things are kind of changing and then they change because of sort of cultural things that might affect that population at that point that weren't affecting the population when the previous decisions were rendered. And if you've accounted for any of that in the analysis.
I thought we were going to wait for a few of them, but I can answer that question. So what we do is we control for the time gap between the two different questions, and the idea is that the shorter the time gap is, the more likely it is that the legal question is the same and the state of the world hasn't changed, so the answer hasn't fundamentally changed. So that's kind of the answer to that. And it's pretty robust to changing that, so doing it in a regression context. But this issue on not looking to other areas, I think actually not looking abroad, it actually is directly related to the question you asked, because I think the rationale that people like Scalia would give for why we don't look abroad is because they're asking a different legal question. In their mind, a different legal question. So it's not the same legal question, and that's why they refuse to go abroad. Different constitution.
Jenny?
Thanks. Just one question for Anup and one for Jeff. Anup, when you see the sort of the change in the pattern of decisions, does that reflect overturning of verdicts? Is that what's captured in that sort of information, and how do you take that into account? And the question for Jeff, so I'll just finish this. I guess I'm not, could you elaborate further on how the anonymous refund wouldn't also have the same result of just having really low contributions?
Oh, yeah, actually. So the answer to that is that we're not looking at any overruling because we're looking at sequences of circuit court cases that are all on the same level within a judiciary. So it's not Supreme Court to appellate. It's appellate followed by another appellate followed by another appellate. And I had the same question for you, which is the rebates. Because the thing is, if I could rebate back, then it seems like one rational response would be that I would give money and then take it all back. And you'd get to a bad equilibrium. Or at least you'd get to an equilibrium where we're politicians aren't funded, which I think is a good equilibrium.
Yeah, no, so, well, first of all, just make sure it's totally clear that I'm not proposing this. I was just sort of, I'm actually just reading my framework onto their work. I mean, they don't actually frame it in this way. They just say, oh, we could do this thing. And for me, this is just one useful example of, you know, how once we realize what the levers are, we can play with them. So that's my only point. And presenting that to you, and because I think you're right, that it doesn't solve that problem. I think the reason that they propose this as sort of a second best option is that this is more politically palatable to actually maintain. I mean, a lot of resistance is on their proposal that we get rid of the attribution requirement. So I think that their idea was, okay, well, we want to keep the central insight of our anonymity strategy, but we have to make it palatable to a world that loves disclosure regimes, so that, you know, and they also add that it actually creates an even messier signal. So their idea is that this signal is even messier than the signal that you get if you just have either, you know, their sort of straightforward anonymity regime where you just have anonymous campaign donations. And for them, they think that's good. I think you're right that it could lead to less donations. Oftentimes, anonymity implementation of anonymity rules will, and voting it did. So I think when anonymous voting was implemented in the United States, there was about a 10% decline in voting. And then, so that's one of the contextual factors I think we have to consider. So actually, in addition to sort of the questions about efficacy that I was talking about, you actually might want to ask the additional question about, you know, what other effects will this rule have on the activity at issue and whether or not those effects are actually desirable. And, you know, some people might say, oh, it'd be great if we got less money in campaigns, whereas maybe if we had this effect in scientific funding for research, we might be less happy with it. So, yeah, there's clearly not going to be a one rule to fit all problems of conflict of interest.
I saw your hand first.
Professor Malani, your model seemed to depend to a great extent on the quality of previous cases. I think at some point you said quality of litigants. And I guess I'm wondering what you mean by quality. It seems like the important quality aspect is the quality of the judge's decision. If the judges are the ones that are censoring their own decisions, deciding whether or not to publish, presumably they all think that their quality of their decision is good.
Well, you know, I think this is how it relates to the very first question about whether or not you think yourself is, you yourself think you are biased, because bias is a version of quality. When I say quality, I mean all sorts of things. I mean the quality of the cases before, or the quality of the facts before you, for example, is the evidence well preserved or not? The quality of the litigants, do they hire good lawyers or bad lawyers? Trust me, there's a wide range. It could also be quality of the judge themselves. I have met judges that know that they're not particularly good at certain things and they're good at other things, or they care about some things and don't care about other things, and they try to avoid the things that they don't really care about, knowing that that means that they're going to more likely to get the wrong error. So that's what I mean by quality. All those possible dimensional attributes, I think the strong assumption which is why I do the empirical tests, is that you actually care about getting the right answer, not just for yourself, but for future cases.
Quality question. There's determinants, I guess, of the likelihood the judge winds up getting it correct, which might be advocates and things, but I would think a subsequent judge is looking to a prior decision and curious about correctness. And you're talking about legal issues, so that would be cases or statutes or canons. I don't know that how good the lawyers were would trickle into that, and I'm having trouble thinking of determinants of kind of correctness of, you know, the accuracy of the signal that would not be reflected in the judicial opinion, because as I understand opinion writing, the norm is normally that any determinant of kind of the ultimate decision is supposed to be in there. So I'm just having trouble thinking of what I as judge two might think judge one knew that he didn't put in his opinion and on your model, and then or she. And then on the empirical point, most circuit splits, or at least the ones I've seen, it's a new insight that is articulated. You know, that is a determination, but it's articulated in the opinion, and then there's a split, and now everybody goes with a second insight, and they say that's the minority view, or that's the lead case that changed it. That seems to me kind of a observable determinant of quality, that the judges, the reason for the split, I mean, the reason for the stickiness there is just that the insight had not yet been kind of had and articulated, and on that model, which I think is just consistent with what you see in written opinions and how circuit splits develop, you would want judges writing opinions for fear that their insights might otherwise go unnoticed. So I guess that's my first one is just a question about how we understand quality, and the second one is, I guess, just an alternative explanation for the empirical results.
So my experience with working as a clerk is that you get very little of the quality of a case when you write a decision. So, you know, we'll get cases. There'll be boxes and boxes of actual record that we have to somehow distill down into, you know, my judge asked me to write 10-page opinions or shorter, and you can't get it all. And so you pick and choose some things. So clearly some aspects of the quality you don't talk about. And we saw lots of bad attorneys, and never in any opinion did we say, and boy, oh boy, did the litigant have a bad attorney. I mean, it's just stuff that we omit because it's not polite to say that. And so I think it's easy to assume, or not controversial to assume, that all the quality attributes of a signal that a judge gets by hearing a case don't show up in the decision. So that's the answer to the first question. The answer to the second question is, it's not obvious to me that just because a new argument comes up later, that's a better argument, just because it was thought of later. I don't know why that's the case. Because, like, so for example, when I think of arguments in my own head about something, often it's not the best argument. The last argument is often not the best argument. It's just like an additional add-on. And courts don't necessarily say, oh, if I can add on a new argument, that means it must be better than all the prior arguments. Does that make sense?
Don't create split because they thought of a bad argument. So we filter. We only see the good ones that create splits.
Oh, I know. And that's consistent. And what I'm saying is that they only deviate. In fact, that's very consistent with the model. They only deviate when they think that last argument that they got is actually a really good argument relative to all the previous arguments. Very often, they'll get a third argument that's different than prior arguments, but they won't think it's good enough to create a split for, right? You only see the ones where, you know, what you said is true, which is where the third argument actually is better than the first two. That's rational.
A couple of alternative explanations occurred to me for some of the empirical findings, and I thought I would sort of lay out what I was thinking, and you can tell me whether you've already ruled it out or might. For David Yokum, I mean, this sort of the fact that blinding can backfire, and the judge who says, ah, but I, you know, I've decided myself that I can be fair, is treated as more credible, if I understood that right. You know, it seems like what psychologists sometimes call a vouching effect. It might also, you know, it occurs to me that this might be sort of a second order effect of the proponent's bias blind spot. So not only do we have a blind spot about our own biases, but we assume other people can have meaningful insight into their own process. And so if a judge is saying, I've looked into my heart and I can assure you from my own introspection that I'm fair, that's somehow more credible than a second party saying, who doesn't have that introspective access. So it could be sort of an echo or a reverberation of the very biased blind spot that you talked about. You know, if this were true, see, I'm being an experimentalist now. If this were true, I would think that people who are themselves more committed to the accuracy of introspection would be more likely to believe that. So in other words, you can look at the kind of things measured by Pronin, and there's undoubtedly a distribution across the population in how, you know, kind of faith in one's own intuitions. And I would think that you would find, if this explanation is true, that faith in one's own intuitions would moderate the finding. Okay, so that's my thought about that.
Yeah, thank you. So I agree with a lot of that. I mean, the irony here is that it's in a little bit of tension with what the bias blind spot itself is. I mean, remember the original finding that I was discussing was that we tend to think that other people can't do what we can do, which is make that accurate assessment. And so the story that you're saying is kind of, I mean, it's kind of saying, well, in this case, they can, because we're suddenly trusting their intuition a lot right there.
Well, we trust them more than a second party, another judge.
You know, so. Yeah, right. Well, I guess, so I don't have data to answer that, but I like your prediction. But it does seem to be some tension to that original bias blind spot finding to me.
While looking at the clock, do we have time for one more, or no?
Maybe one more?
It's 5:30. We should wrap up. So please join me in thanking our distinguished panel, and we'll continue the conversation later. Thanks.
All right, so to just kind of wrap up and provide a few final thoughts. First thing I want to do is I want to ask everybody to give a round of applause for Heidi, who has organized today's conference and helped make the claims. Let's make sure everyone is on time. I don't see Stephanie and Katie, but they were also very helpful in organizing. Katie's organizing dinner, so great. So hopefully I'm sure that will go just as well as the conference today went. But so we started today learning a little bit about the landscape of blinding and institutional corruption. We heard from Sunita Saw about how conflicts lead to bias and the justifications of that professionals use in responding to that bias and the limits of disclosure. We heard from Scott Podolsky about how blinding has developed in the health sciences to increase scientific rigor and to decrease, I liked the turn of phrase that he used, the personal equation that is involved in decision making. And then from Jonathan Marks about the limits of blinding and how broader systemic issues exist in health and medical sciences that blinding won't address. After that, we transitioned to three examples of how blinding has played out in the medical sciences and its strengths and weaknesses, providing insight in some of the ethical underpinnings of blinding in medicine. Frank Miller talked about implementing blinding and the use of deception in single-blinded clinical trials. Robert Green about blinding in genetics and how current blinding norms can be detrimental to patients' knowledge and health. And then Jonathan Gingrich with his great Boston strong beard going there, about how blinding in the journal context can provide fair and reasonable decision making. So then after the lunch break, we turn to an area where blinding is much less of a historical precedent, which is the forensic science. And the first group focused on blinding and bias in courtroom sciences. First, we heard from Bill Thompson about reviewing the distinction between the different types of forensic information and asking the insightful question about when we blind, what sort of data are we supposed to be blinding ourselves to, and what the implications of that are. Jim Greiner then talked about causal inferences made in the courtroom, and Michael Reisinger about the weaknesses of eyewitness identification and the importance of those weaknesses on courtroom outcomes. Roger Koppel and the next group then reviewed how blinding could be implemented in forensic science and what societal and governmental limitations exist for the use of blinding in that arena. Dan Duran discussed methods of blinding radiologists to decrease selection bias and contextual bias. And then Megan Wright talked about the impact of blinding on mock jurors in her experiments. And then finally, we ended the day with a bit more of a theoretical discussion about blinding in these areas. Yokum, as I guess we're supposed to call him, discussed the application of psychological theory to self-evaluation of bias among judges. And parallels, I thought the parallels there were very interesting with the struggles with conflicts of interest among physicians as well. Amin Malani discussed blinding of future generations from legal decisions of judges in prior similar cases, and Jeff Skopek about anonymity and its implications in the law for decisions. I'm sorry, you know, we did cover a lot of different disciplines, and it was a very full day. I'm sorry we didn't get to other disciplines in which blinding might be relevant, such as sports and the controversies that arise when one team attempts to break the blind that another team has in its signals, or blinding in popular culture in TV shows like The Voice. Or when two celebrities blinded to what each of them are going to wear show up at an event wearing the same thing, and then my wife gets to determine who wore it better. But I think we can address those in future conferences that I hope you guys will return for. Thank you very much.